Blackstone Audio presents On the Road with Bob Dylan by Larry Ratso Sloman. This book is read by Ramiz Monsef. Dedicated to my parents, Lynn, and the memory of Phil Oakes. My fellow Armenians. The shit in this book hit the old ceiling fan 27 years ago. Some of you may not even have been born then. Or, what is more likely, you may have been conceived on this tour. At least a dozen of the colorful players in this traveling soap opera called the Rolling Thunder Revue have now been bugled to Jesus, and many others wish they were dead, including myself. It's certainly preferable to writing this introduction for the kind of money I'm sure Ratso will give me. He's a superb chronicler of events, but he does have fish hooks in his pockets. The one person we know that hasn't gone to Jesus yet is Bob Dylan. Bob may stay on the road forever. He may never be bugled to Jesus. Maybe Bob is Jesus. They're both skinny little boogers, and they're both Jews. Today, of course, we like to refer to them as fellow Red Sea pedestrians. But back to whatever the hell I was writing about before I started hearing voices in my head. If you're a young person picking up this classic manuscript for the first time, it may seem as important as stumbling across a secular version of the Dead Sea fucking scrolls. You know you should have been there, but you weren't, and like a pedigreed dog, it's not your fault. Like a knight born out of time, you realize that some of these dreamers and jet-set gypsies could have been your brothers and sisters and friends and lovers, kindred spirits from a different world that today seems more spiritual and also more real. On the other hand, have you explored a career at Starbucks? I am, for a number of reasons, very gratified to see this book of Ratso's back in print again. For one thing, it means royalties for Ratso, which I suppose is a good thing. Not that I expect him to ever pick up the check, of course. He never has, and he never will. Some things never change. But some do. Things like culture and society and the way each generation looks at the world. Bob himself said, "Art should not reflect culture. Art should subvert culture." This, I believe, is a worthy goal. For if Ratso has captured anything in this comprehensive yet subtle book, it is the casual and innermost thoughts, comments and dreams, sometimes beautiful beyond words and music, sometimes quite prophetic, that emanated from a small band of brigands traveling across America in that year of our Lord 1975, long before, I hasten to add, the country somehow managed to transmogrify itself into a non-smoking family chain restaurant. Since I've forgotten the first half of my life, I don't remember all that much about the 60s and 70s. For instance, I don't recall whether I called the girl in my hotel room a slut or a slit anymore, and I'm not going to argue with Ratso over which term of endearment it was. At least I had the good sense not to call her honey, because then we might have possibly gotten married, had three kids, and right now I'd probably be masturbating like a monkey in the men's room of a non-smoking family chain restaurant. The more important point here is, however, that Ratso is an unconventional journalist of uncommon integrity. His eye is a digital camera, and his ear is comparable to the most high-tech DVD the Japanese can produce. Not to mention the fact that he made a major nuisance of himself on this tour, as I remember, running around 24 hours a day like a frenetic ferret on angel dust, with a tape recorder and a strangely intense yet intelligent look in his eye that, in retrospect, reminds me vaguely of Ted Bundy. Ratso got Bob right. Indeed, he got just about everybody right. This was not an easy feat to accomplish, since many of us were so high we needed a hook and ladder truck to scratch our asses. And besides, it was the mid-70s and we didn't know what we were talking about anyway. But getting Bob right, that's the big item here. Very few people have gotten Bob Dylan right. ever since the day he left Hibbing, Minnesota, with nothing but a guitar, a harmonica, and a determined little smile that, in retrospect, reminds me vaguely of Ted Bundy. Yet Ratso has succeeded where others through the years have failed. He has provided us with a highly accurate reading of one of the most incandescent and inscrutable stars in the galaxy. And I don't mean that popular four-wheeled penis of the 60s, the Ford Galaxy. Leave it to America to name a car Galaxy. At any rate, Ratso has given the reader a rare snapshot in time of Bob Dylan. A man who can be as irretrievably antisocial, for all the right reasons, as a cat I once loved, and still do. The time is the mid-70s. The snapshot will take you many pages to see in totality, but it is impeccable. And I don't know how Ratso managed to do it, because Bob does not suffer gladly those who would reveal the contents of the inside pockets of his youth. He hates to be photographed, for instance, because he believes that every time a picture of him is taken, it takes away a little bit more of the chance that he might become an Indian when he grows up. Some years back, I met an Irish singer in Norway who'd recently been performing in an underground club in Austria. He told me that a bearded guy dressed all in black walked in one night with a large sign hung around his neck. The sign read, "Allen Ginsberg is dead." At first, the Irish singer thought that this was some kind of performance art statement. Then he realized it for what it was. Allen Ginsberg was dead. Of course, compared to fat people driving SUVs and talking on cell phones, he seems pretty much alive. Along with Allen, there are many others from the pages of this tome who've stepped on a rainbow. You could call it Ratso's curse, or quite possibly, they just got tired of being on the road. A partial list includes Rick Danko, Mick Ronson, David Blue, Dave Van Ronk, Howie Wyeth, Abby Hoffman, Larry Keegan, Richard Manuel, Phil Oakes, and Michael Bloomfield. An interesting, if somewhat macabre, sidelight upon the deaths of Oakes and Bloomfield is that both parties slept upon Ratso's old, decrepit, skid-marked couch immediately prior to falling through the trapdoor. Some people, no doubt, will do anything to avoid sleeping on Ratso's couch. I've slept on Ratso's couch as well, of course, and against all odds, I'm still alive. But I won't be if I don't terminate this tissue of horse shit soon and get something to eat. I am, as it happens, a vegetarian currently because I want to be kind to animals.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.